I'm Coco Novak, author, show host, and public speaker. Welcome to season two of The Coco Novak Show. In this season, we're going to delve deep into what makes us human, relationships, stories of failure that we learn from, and stories of success. It's going to be real, raw, and relatable. So stay tuned, hit that subscribe button, and enjoy. Subhan, welcome to Tuesday Talks.
Thank you. Thank you for having me.
Lovely to have you as a guest. We'll talk about something quite different today, and that's yoga. You're a classical yoga teacher. Is that how we say?
Hatha yoga. Yes.
So sorry.
That's all right. The significance will come up, I'm sure, at some point.
Yes, we definitely need to know the difference. And the slogan is traditional yoga for modern life.
Yes.
So what does that mean? And how does that, we talk about relationships, so how does that kind of relate to relationships with ourselves, I guess, ultimately?
Yeah, that's basically what it is. In terms of classical, the aspect of classical, it just means bringing the aspects of yoga back, which are forgotten. It was the ancient, it's a very ancient practice. And of course, over the years, it's changed, it's been distorted. However, the whole tradition, the system was set up in such a way that that wouldn't happen. And there was a specific way in which they did that. And this is an attempt to bring that back. And because of that, it means, you know, we're able to be the best version of ourselves. And you need to be the best version of yourself when you're going
into the most important relationship at the end of the day, right?
Yes, absolutely.
We're not happy with ourselves. It's difficult to share that.
Yeah, absolutely. When you're joyful, that's when you're at your best. And that's when you can, you know, you can be of service to other people and all of these things that we aspire to do.
Yeah.
And our capability, if you just observe yourself, our capability is much more when we're joyful. When we're miserable, everything is much lower. Energy levels are much lower. The way we think is definitely much lower, if you want to call it that. So yeah, joyful is definitely the way to be.
Yeah. So is the yoga that we practice, I don't know whether it's in health clubs or yoga.
You're going to take me there.
I'm just wondering how different is it? Because a lot of us, I guess, because
yes.
I love yoga. I've never done traditional yoga.
Yes, yes.
So as soon as I heal, I'll come with to you.
Okay.
But how different is yoga that most of us do versus traditional,
yeah,
I guess, proper yoga?
We'll stick with classical. Okay. I don't want to put anyone else's offerings down, you know.
Okay. And also, how did it come here? How did it come to the Western world, I guess?
That's a really good question as well. So where do we start? I mean, one thing, like I said, I don't want to talk about other people's yoga, but we're talking about classical yoga and how it was, you know, passed down. It's always passed down through a lineage. So you have a master who passes it down to, you know, the next person in line. And then it's been passed down through a certain lineage for thousands of years. However, and this is me reading between the lines a little bit as well. So there is no, I don't want to say anything that might be a little bit off, a bit controversial, shall we say? Well, I mean, the facts are that during British era, yoga was banned. And it was, yeah, so it went underground.
So yoga originates from India. Let's have that clarity.
Yes, I would say essentially the story starts in the Himalayas.
Right.
That's where it started. And yes, the majority of that came down into India, all the way down to the south. And there are certain yogis who were there and who spread the knowledge of it in various places. So one of those yogis is where my lineage is connected to.
Right.
This is a very long time ago.
Mm-hmm.
And the numbers, they vary. But if you look according to some of the stories and the way they date it is mapping the astrological events of that time, because there was no recording, right? Yeah. There was nothing like this. So we say at least 15,000 years ago.
Wow.
Which sends archaeologists a bit crazy.
Right.
And, you know, that's what we say in terms of at least. Some records go, say, 40,000 years ago and things like this. The good thing is now there is a little bit more archaeological evidence of human activity about 40,000 years ago. They found bones and things. So there seems to be a little bit of a catch up mm-hmm. with that story. However, it's still a long way to go.
Okay.
But this is what it said in the yogic system, in the yogic law.
The yogic law.
I mean, not L-A-W-L-O-R-E.
Right. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
So, so that's kind of the origins of it. And yeah, in India is where it really got developed, it got explored, and a lot of the wisdom was taught.
Right.
We're going into another story now. Okay. There is a story where, you know, there were seven main yogis who were given this knowledge, and that's where the story comes from. And they were sent out to different parts of the world as well. And one of them was the one that came to South India. And that one seems to have maintained over a certain period of time, where the other ones have, there's still evidence of it, but it's died down. A lot of the tradition has died down in those places. Now we're going into archaeology. See where you're taking me?
Get out of that for a minute. Let's not go down too many rabbit holes.
Yes, yes.
Let's talk about why it was forbidden during the English rule. That's or the British rule.
Yes.
That's interesting.
It is, yeah. See, when we say the word yogi these days, it means someone who's wearing Lululemon.
Yeah. I can't about that one.
However, a yogi is someone who is very immersed in the practice. Usually you would see them in the mountains, in the caves, dreadlocks, you know, wearing nothing but a loincloth. And these guys look very freaky, you know, to say the least. But they also showed a certain level of capability as well. You know, they were able to do certain things which really, I guess, scared a lot of what the people that were there around that time. So it was one of the very things that got outlawed was yoga, because there was like, anyone who practices, that's it. It's
What kind of things would they do that people around them scared?
So there is this whole aspect of yoga. When you start mastering yourself, mm-hmm. you're able to do certain things which exhibit a certain level of extraordinary capability.
Like what?
So, I mean, the famous one is when you see people levitate.
Yes, okay.
So that, you know, these are the kind of sightings that people saw at, you know, at certain times. It goes way beyond that. And in fact, George Lucas, the maker of Star Wars, you know, he was very much in that hippie movement. A lot of what he based the Star Wars on in terms of the Jedis were stories he read from the yogis mm-hmm. and their extraordinary capabilities. So even things like using their mind in extraordinary ways.
Jedi mind trick.
Yeah, there you go. You see where I'm going. So there are innumerable stories about their level of mastery over their surroundings, over themselves. And I guess some of these were witnessed.
Right.
And that was it. They didn't want anyone having any level of capability that threatened them.
Sure.
That was one thing that was outlawed, and you know, various other things like certain martial arts techniques, all of these things were outlawed that was any kind of threat at that time.
So did it just go underground?
It went underground.
Right. Okay.
Yes. With yoga, it was being taught in closed circles like this. After a period of time, there were certain yogis who tried to bring it back, and then it went into palaces. And there, a way of bringing it back was to exhibit it. I mean, it became an exhibition.
Right.
So they were doing extraordinary things with their bodies and, you know, showing various capabilities. It became a performance type thing. Mm. And then once it started becoming performance type thing, it was allowed as a performance,
right.
as an exhibition.
It was rebranded.
Yes, yeah. That was the only version of it that was allowed. However, the moment you take it into this way of doing things, something that is a very spiritual practice will now become something very different, which is more for show, more for mm-hmm. outside. So this kind of branch of yoga started happening in India even before it went anywhere else. So then once it started coming over to places like the West, there was already some distortions and deviations happening. Mm-hmm. And then once that happened, then that's it. It just opened up to so many other things, right, which we see today.
Okay. So let's move back a little bit.
Yes, sure.
In the story, about you and how you came to be a yogi master. Okay. Can we call you that?
I wouldn't call myself a yogi master. Yeah.
So tell us a little bit about your childhood, because you started practicing meditation and yoga at a very young age.
I did, yes.
So tell us a little bit how you got into that.
Sure. That was down to my parents. So right. My parents were immigrants from India, came to the UK, and my father specifically started teaching me some type of practice. This was a lot of chanting, and it was a closed-eyed practice. And this was when I was about 3 or 4.
Wow.
And I was just happy to get this because I saw my dad doing something, I saw my mum doing something, so I got to do something. Mm. And I remember very clearly when I was doing these practices, the feeling of myself changed. I just noticed there was a distinct change in my feeling, and I enjoyed that feeling. So I was very happy to keep doing it. And I did it every day until my teenage years, basically. And once I hit my teenage years, then this was no longer of interest anymore.
That's very disciplined for a child that age to do something every single day.
Yeah. It was interesting. I mean, apart from when I was sick, then I didn't.
Fine, yeah.
However, I did it every day, and it was just something I did without question. I didn't really think too much about it. It was just something I liked to do. As I got older, that's when I started questioning it a little bit. And why am I doing this? Mm. And I started discovering video games and playing with other. And that was more exciting at that time. Well, being with my friends was, more exciting. And so that's when I stopped that. And I completely did a 180 against anything that was remotely spiritual and went very much atheist and didn't believe in anything. Because once I started questioning everything, I was like, well, what was the purpose of all this? Why am I doing all this? And so I went on that path, and I was quite happy doing that at that time.
So you had a mainstream job, I think. Did you work in the city, or?
Yeah, it was local. It was in a college, and it was a regular 9-to-5 job within that college, helping.
So no meditating, no yoga, just a 9-to-5.
Yeah, it was pretty much that, and come sit on the sofa, watch TV, and that's all I had the energy for. And, I got into that trap, living for the weekend. Mm. I was waiting for Friday, and everyone else was doing it, so I thought that was normal. So, I didn't think anything different from that.
So fully enjoying the rat race.
Enjoying is debatable.
So how did you manage to get yourself out of that? Because I think a lot of people are trapped in this. I have to pay my bills. I'm going to go to work.
Yes.
I don't find it fulfilling, this and that. But people don't change, or they're scared of change.
Yes.
So what happened?
Well, essentially, I ended up in a yoga program. that's basically what changed. So I started following, I think many people know Sadhguru now. So he I would say, is a yogi master.
Okay.
So I started following his talks. I discovered his talk by accident in many ways. It was my mum actually who first discovered him.
Right.
And then I came down and she was watching him and I was looking for breakfast. My mum said, oh, look, this is that yogi and, mystic I was telling you about. Mm. I was like, really now? I sat down, I listened, and I thought, well, hang on, there's something to this, there's a point. So I started regularly watching him after that, and then it just got to the point where I couldn't miss it. I was so fascinated with the things he was saying. And then eventually he said he was going to come, well, it said on the end of the program he was coming to London. Mm-hmm. So I was like, okay, I'll go and see him in London. And then he announced that we're thinking of running one of our courses here, one of our programs. So I said, okay, sign me up. Well, why not? I thought the only way to understand what it was to do it, because it was the first time it was going to happen at that time.
Right.
So there
How
was
many
no.
How many years ago was this?
This was 18 years ago.
Okay.
More than 18 years ago.
Okay. Is it when the student is ready? The master appears?
I believe so, actually. I do believe so. And So yeah, I signed up to it, and it took a few months for the, you know, the program to happen. It was a 3-day program, and then we got taught a certain practice in that as well. And actually, funny, so we're talking about this. It was 18 years ago to this day.
Wow.
That I actually learned that practice.
Wow.
So it's very much fitting.
Very good.
Yeah. And so then once I'd done that, and it was, you know, even though it was a yoga program, it wasn't, there was hardly any stretching actually. And that was, you know, that was quite interesting. The practice I was taught was a seated practice.
Okay.
And there was a lot of exploration of the mind and various other aspects of life. So that was really something very eye-opening for me. So having done that practice and come out of that program, I started practicing and I saw distinct changes in myself. I saw my energy levels were higher. I saw various things like my sleep was reducing. And this wasn't, you know, I was waking up before my alarm.
I
had enough sleep, but it was just I was surviving on less sleep. And so I saw very distinct changes. But the biggest thing I remember was after, you know, a full day of work, I still had energy. And I didn't want to go home.
Okay.
So then I started looking for things to do. And I just found myself just taking up classes and all those things that I've aspired to do or try. All of a sudden, those opportunities were appearing and I was seeing them and I was taking them. So all of a sudden, I had all this extracurricular activity because I didn't want to go straight home. I wanted to do something with this energy. So I was no longer living for the weekend. I was living for every day.
Wow.
And that was such a distinct shift in my experience of life. And that's when I really started going into yoga and what it was and understanding what it was and practicing it. It just became a part of my life.
Is that when you went to the ashram or?
Not straight away. It took me a few years.
Okay. So did you still go to your job and just do more yoga?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes. So I was still doing my job. And I was still, you know, I was joining in with all the other courses as a volunteer.
Right.
So I was a part of the organization by that time, as well as doing all the other activities that I was doing. So the more I was part of the program that I'd gone through myself, mm-hmm. it really opened up more things because when you're hearing the same words, you hear it from a different angle and then it deepens your whole journey about, you know, understanding yourself a little bit more. So then this led me to doing other courses initially. And then it just got, actually, initially, I actually went to the Himalayas.
Oh, right.
Okay. Yeah. So that was the first thing that happened. After that, I decided, okay, I think I need to start visiting the ashram.
Right. So who did you go to the Himalayas with?
With Sadhguru.
Right. So tell us more about him. So what kind of...
Yes.
So, okay, you saw him on TV.
Mm.
You went to his... event in London.
Mm.
So how did he, what influence did he have in your life? Clearly quite profound.
Yeah, it was. It was huge. I remember when I went to the talk before I did the program that he was running, he sat there talking for 3 hours, sat in the same space without a single drop in his energy.
Wow.
And I knew that was something.
Wow.
Because I've tried to talk for an hour and how exhausted I was. And so I thought, okay, there is something here to that. And then when I started hear him talk about certain aspects, especially regarding spirituality, yoga, there was a distinct clarity with what how he explained things and the way mm-hmm. he spoke about things. And that really resonated with me because up until that point, I was reading a lot of books from lots of different people about various different subjects, about, you know, spirituality, improving yourself. However, this was different because I think I got to that point where I think I know it all now.
Yeah.
I've read every book. I've listened to every talk. I'm fine. He put it in such a different way. I was like, I never thought of that. And that makes a lot of sense. So I love the way he was able to clearly explain things.
He does,
yeah.
Yeah. Once in a while too.
Yes.
Very wise man.
Yes, indeed, indeed. And yeah, so then that really allowed me to self-inquire a lot more. And then I started doing different courses and I was lucky enough back then to do the courses directly with him.
Right.
And, you know, each course that I did just opened me up a little bit more, opened up my experience of myself a little bit more. And I started having what most people call a spiritual experience. I've started experiencing these things and I wanted to know more about that. So that's when I decided eventually to go to the ashram and go full time and live there and live that lifestyle. He would hate me calling that a lifestyle, but yeah, that way of life.
Is it difficult or is it just so different? Because I'm also imagining a lot of people don't want to dig deep into themselves because who knows what comes up.
Yes. Yeah, it's not something you should just do just like that.
Yeah.
And this is where the yoga practice comes in.
Right.
So you do the yoga practice to bring a certain level of balance to yourself. Only if you're in a balanced place, only if you're in a secure place, when you start seeing these things, you're able to explore them and face them head on.
Right.
If you do it otherwise, if you just jump into it, and there are various, you know, practices out there who just go, right, just straight face yourself, and things come up that people can't handle. Mm. So you have to be balanced when you do these things. So doing these practices, it made me feel very secure enough to jump into it a lot more. Mm.
Does someone guide you through it when you're...
Yes.
Okay, so you're not just there alone dealing with your own things.
No, no. There's, you know, there's monks who live there.
Right.
And there's various teachers that have been trained who live there, who've gone through a certain level of experience as well. And then you get to hear from Sadhguru. You know, he gives talks, and a lot of the times the talks just seem to be relevant to you.
Interesting how we hear what we need to hear.
Yes, absolutely, absolutely. So, you know, there is this whole idea of an ashram that when things get difficult, you know, we're going to run away to this place and it's just a paradise. And yeah, externally, you've got all, you know, nature is everywhere and there's so much you can do there. However, it is a place of transformation. That's what an ashram is. It is a place where you are working on yourself, but it's a safe space to do that. There's a lot of support systems. You know, there are people there and the energy is, you know, created in such a way that it's safe. Yeah.
Can anyone go?
Anyone can go, but I think there is a limit when you first go.
Right.
So when you first go, there is a limit of a week just to see how you get on with it. Okay. You can extend your stay whilst you're there.
Okay.
But officially, it's a week stay initially. And I think that's a good thing.
Okay. And what kind of a phase in people's lives, where do you have to be in your life to want to go to an ashram to work on yourself? Do people go like really, you know, down, or are people kind of okay with themselves and they just want to discover more?
So I'd say both. Mm-hmm. I think a lot of the times the idea, especially in India, it's when your life fails, then you go to the ashram like it's some kind of rehab or something. And I've met so many people who were inspired and went there and they were telling me how their parents asked them, well, what's wrong? Why are you going there? You know, because that's the perception.
Right.
In my case, and in most...
What, something wrong with you. That's why you have to go.
Yes, yeah. To go and fix yourself because life isn't working out. You know, they see that as the secondary place. However, for me, and I know a lot of people that I've spoken to, life got better. Things were really going well. And it was just more of, okay, I want to know more of... What is it that you feel that makes you feel well? And what is it that leads from there to a spiritual experience? And it was just all these questions I had. So I just wanted to immerse myself in that. So for me, it was everything outside was great. However, it just got to the point where this isn't enough for me. I want more. Mm.
So how long were you there for?
So initially, I went back and forth a little bit. So I went for a month and then I went with a one-way ticket and I stayed there for about a year. And then after a year, a lot of things were apparent to me that I didn't want to become a monk anymore.
Okay. Is that when you met your future wife?
It was before that. It was before that. And I had that discussion with her and I said, okay, if I'm going to come down this road with you, then I'm saying no to that. However, once I went there, I knew that definitely was not an option for me. And I was quite happy with not living that type of life. And because if you're, you know, going down that road, it's something that has to be 100%.
Yeah, for sure.
It's a big, big choice. So, So I think after a year, I felt like that now it was time to come back and take the learnings that I had and see what I can do here. And So that was the end of that story. But after that, that's when I went back for the teacher training and went. So it was there for a further 8 months.
Wow.
So the teacher training is almost 6 months. It's a very in-depth teacher training. It's 7 days a week, every day, 5:30 start till 9, 10 o'clock at night. It's very intense. However, the whole idea is you transform yourself before you actually are in a position to transform others.
I mean, yeah, you would hope so. Right?
Yeah,
I mean,
yeah.
That should be the whole, any teaching profession, but...
It should be.
I'm sure we always achieve it, but yeah, the goal is there.
Yes.
Okay, interesting. And so is that all you do nowadays? You... What do? You teach yoga?
Yeah. So
traditional yoga.
Yeah. So the classical.
Is Lululemon allowed? Can I come in with Lululemon? My mat is Lululemon.
Well, well. Okay, yeah, I won't tell you what to wear. I'll give you the information of what the difference is, and then you choose.
Okay. Choose wisely, right?
Yes. So, yeah, in terms of what I do, the past 10 years I've been teaching classical Hatha Yoga, and that's been pretty much a full-time thing. Recently, I've become a coach as well. So trained by the Coactive Training Institute using the Coactive model. Now, I didn't want to go anywhere near coaching and that whole industry, the whole personal development industry. I liked the premise of it, but I didn't like what I saw.
Right.
So I stayed away from this. However, it was during lockdown and the pandemic, and you know, one thing about classical Hatha Yoga, you can't teach it online.
Okay.
It always has to be in person because the atmosphere in which you learn it is also very important. Okay. So whilst I was there, I was thinking about things, and then I wanted to have a bit more direct contact one-to-one and have something where I can use this medium to reach people and get them more aware of themselves so they're on that path towards transforming themselves to be better. Mm. So coaching came back into my sphere. However, I started looking at coaching. I still didn't like what I saw until I saw the Coactive model. And this was the first model that was that was looking at the being first.
Right.
And that was somewhere in line with what I knew about yoga. It's about focusing on the being. Once you focus on the being, then you can start looking at what to do and what not to do. The action part comes afterwards. But the quality of the action is determined by how you are within yourself.
So what would that look like? How do you start working with someone? What is it, coactive?
Yes, coactive, yeah. So, yeah, so being a coactive coach, there are four pillars in the coactive coaching model. Mm-hmm. So the first pillar is every single person is naturally creative, resourceful, and whole, which is a distinct parallel with yoga as well, because you're focusing on the whole being, which is the second pillar. You focus on the whole being, and they're whole by themselves.
Right.
The other thing is you always dance in the moment with them. So, you know, whatever comes up, you know, it's not preconceived. You're fully connected with the person. And the last one is you evoke transformation. So the idea is you create some kind of transformation that they take away with them. Now, that kind of transformation which happens in coaching can be anything. It can be a kind of a shift. It could be a different perspective. Some kind of transformation happens. So once you start guiding people in this way from a place of self-awareness, now you have a few more options. Now, for me, that whole aspect of self-awareness was the important thing.
Mm.
I found many people who even came to yoga were just not very self-aware. They were very much focused on external things. Mm. And it's the external things that were giving their life...
Yeah, validation.
Validation, identity, various things. And just being focused on just how you feel, for some people, even that is very difficult. So just to bring some level of self-awareness within them, and then taking them in down a yogic practice is way more powerful. So this is why I started doing the coaching. And now the idea is I want to start bringing the Eastern wisdom of yoga and everything that I've learned through yoga and start applying it to the coaching model, which is somewhere a more modern way of doing things. So I'm doing coaching, but I want to do it differently.
Mm. Is it one-to-one or is it group?
At the moment, it's one-to-one. Mm-hmm. And we will be going into group coaching as well. That's the next stage. And the idea is also retreats where we bring everything together.
Tell us a little about, let's talk about relationships a little bit.
Sure.
So you met your now wife.
Yes.
When you were just about to head off for a year.
Yes.
To the ashram.
That's correct.
She also, though, went to the ashram at some point.
She did.
Right?
Yes.
So how did that long distance relationship look like? And how did you guys manage to stick it out for that long a time? That's almost 2 years.
Yeah, I think it was more than that in the end. Yeah, so when I met her, she was doing her PhD.
Right.
And I was very much going down this yoga path, and I'd already made my decision that I want to go to India and be there. So we weren't sure how it was going to work, but once it came to that point, we decided, okay, we're going to stay together. And yeah, long distance relationships aren't easy. However, we were very much involved in what we were doing. So I was very much involved with the ashram life and the trainings I was going through there. And she was very much focused on the PhD. It was difficult because at that time, I couldn't really call back as often because the kind of training I was doing, I literally had half an hour in the day and it was the early part of the day. Mm. And at that time, UK is asleep.
Right.
So it meant, and yeah, so then it basically meant I had to sacrifice sleep to talk to anyone back home, whether it's my wife, whether it's my parents, you know, anybody. Mm. And that was just how it was. You know, I was put into this training and I was happy to go down that training. However, it was, for me, what happened was it was the thought of them that kept me going.
All right. Okay.
And so for me, that strengthened the relationship. So when I came back, it was more stronger for me. There was a huge commitment for me at that moment because I understood the value of this all the relationships, yeah. But particularly that relationship as well. But yeah, she went and finished her PhD and then she went. So this play was there.
Wow.
However, I think the thing was there was a deep understanding that this was important to us. And, you know,
so you understood each other's goals and exactly. Ambitions, where you want to
be. Yeah, I couldn't be in a relationship where that wasn't there.
Yeah, I agree.
You know, when we got together, it made sense. You know, I encouraged her to go and, you know, spend time there. And I was happy. I was happy for that as well.
But she met Sadhguru on her own.
Yes. So we met through, you know, these events that were run by the Isha Foundation, which is the organization that Sadhguru runs. And so that's where we saw each other and we spoke. And the funny thing was I was very much thinking I'm celibate. Right. Okay. So when this conversation came up, I was like, I'm not sure. I don't know, you know. So it took me a while to come round to this point, okay, let's try this because there is something there and it feels good. And if I was to go into a relationship, it's someone who's also, you know, going down the same road as me. And then eventually I had to make that decision. Okay, right, if I'm going down this road, then there's no question about going and becoming a monk.
Hmm.
And I told her that was the decision I'm making. It's nothing to do with you.
Yeah.
Well, if I say yes to you, I've got to say no to that. That's only fair on you. So, you know, and then that's what happened. And I think it's been something that's grown, you know, in our relationship in a big way. But it's the whole idea is we're growing by ourselves as well. So that's not dependent on one another. We just support the other one in what they're doing. Away from that, it's just, you know, it's just a support system for us, you know, emotionally and in every other way that you can get in this type of relationship.
How do you set that up? Because I think a lot of people struggle with exactly that. How do you have your own life and your own life?
Yes.
Not maybe be in competition or jealous with one another or not understanding because, oh, why are you doing this?
Yeah.
You have other intentions, but it's actually, no, I just want to do this. But then at the same time, you come together and the relationship is, you know, sweet and nice and how it's meant to be.
I can only talk about my own experience. Yeah. And something that I learned through yoga is you work on yourself, you become balanced, you become secure. you know, this is the, for me, the fundamental thing that helped me in this relationship. Once you start becoming secure within yourself, then now it's not about what can I take from you, what can I rely on you or depend on you for this relationship or for myself, essentially. That's what's happening. So if you are strong, you know, you're secure within yourself and you're balanced within yourself, then all of a sudden you can just enjoy the other person. And because we were both on that path, don't get me wrong, there's been ups and downs.
Not all bliss.
No. However, when those things come up, you have the tools to deal with them. It's just as painful as anything else.
Yeah.
However, you know, you do have the tools and you can talk, you know, sort things out in a different way. And you see that, you know, there's a commitment there to one another, to, you know, for the other person, as well as to make this work.
So would you say that once you're balanced, and hopefully your partner is balanced, you never know, right?
You never know.
Yeah. And also, you might not always be balanced. Maybe you're balanced sometimes, but then, you know, something knocks you off your heel, which can
absolutely
happen in life, right?
Yeah, yeah.
I guess trust would be the overriding term or feeling or whatever.
Yes.
Because without that, you don't really have a lot.
Absolutely. Trust has to be there. Trust has to be there. And clarity as well. You've got to have a certain level of clarity.
Sure. I like that.
So if you're, you know, if you do see yourself growing as a being, then it's, you're in a better place to spot those things, because your perception is a little bit better. You see things a little bit more clearer. So if you can see that this, you know, this person is also growing with you and this is something that's working, then you naturally gravitate towards it. However, if you see that it's not working, you have to first address it, or this is, you know, what through my experience, you have to address it first and then see, is this something that we can move forward with or not? However, I always come back to, it starts with yourself. And this is not just, you know, relationships. It's every relationship, really. You've got to be strong, balanced within yourself. And then you'll see relationships, all types of relationships flourish. You know, here we talk about relationships as the romantic relationship. Yeah. And that seems to be the most important relationship. And in, for example, the East, the relationship in all sides is very important. You know, this is one relationship in many other relationships. So the relationship with your parents is very much important. How you respect them, that's one thing. Relationship with other elders, relationship with your neighbors. So everything is a part of the same thing. Without all of those things, then, you know, you can't move forward together. And it's a support system as well. So it's interesting, and it was something that Sadhguru said that pointed that out that made me realize that here is, when you say a relationship, it's automatically a romantic relationship. And that just suggests that that's the most important relationship. However, every single relationship you have, you know, is important, and it feeds to the other ones as well.
Interesting. Mm-hmm. So what about... Okay, so things happen in life.
Yes.
And you, I don't know, one person has issues.
Yes.
And has whatever going on.
Yes.
How do you kind of cross that bridge when you're like, okay, we're in this together, you know, I'm your support system, but then let's say that's taking a long time.
Yes.
Maybe you're getting fed up with the length of all this.
Yes.
And how do you kind of cope with that? Because, you know, once you decide that you're together, you're married, whatever.
Yes.
It should kind of be in the same trajectory, but obviously life happens. So it how does. Do we deal with that?
It does take a certain level of maturity, I think.
I think that's a good word.
Yeah.
I think,
It also depends on how far the relationship has come. Once it gets to a certain level, and once you have that certain level of maturity, then you know, that level of commitment you have to the other person. And you know them, right? Ideally, you know them. So you know it, by supporting them, you're going to get them back to the place they are. And, you know, when you've got to think about yourself, if you're in that situation, what would you need? What would you want? So, it is just in that moment, you just got to give to the capacity you can. You've got to have some level of self-care as well. However, it is about holding space, holding them, and... Yeah, it's just that connection and that love and that care and compassion you have for that person. If it has that level of strength, you will support them through it. And again, it also depends on, you know, are they willing to help themselves? And there are various other factors to this. However, in your part, the first part is, you know, you offer yourself. You know, there's this whole thing in spirituality about something we call a seva, which is selfless service. Mm-hmm. It's one of the first things, or in yoga, it's called karma yoga. It can be called that as well, which is the yoga of action and the yoga of service, essentially. So the way you create this is, you know, in some, let's say, a spiritual, well, let's say the ashram, for example, mm-hmm. one of the things there is volunteering, which essentially is seva. And that is part of your spiritual process. Right. Just giving yourself without actually wanting, you know, saying this, I'm doing this because of this. It's not a transaction. Mm. It's not a calculated action. It's you pouring your heart into it. If you're passionate about something, you'll do that anyway.
Yeah. That's so true. So, like this podcast.
Yeah, there you go. Yes, absolutely. Mm. It's just nothing has really evolved in life without someone pouring their heart into that.
True.
And it's the same thing. You would do that for another person. It's a beautiful thing.
Yeah, it is, actually. I agree. And do you think maybe any relationship, but specifically a romantic one, let's say you're going through the issues, one has issues, you're supporting him.
Yes.
Does it actually end up strengthening that relationship once you're on the other side of it?
100%. In my experience, 100%.
So it's worth taking a little bit of pain.
Yes. Yes, I mean, and don't see it as painful.
Yeah.
That's the thing.
Yeah, fair enough.
Just see it as a loving gesture. Mm. You're just offering yourself. Like I said, it's a beautiful thing. If you can really give yourself in that way and you see the improvement in that person, of course it's going to strengthen your relationship.
Yeah, which is great, right?
Yeah, absolutely.
Amazing. Okay, so let's say that everyday people do everyday yoga.
Okay.
Just like it's better than nothing.
Yes. Well, in saying that, you know, Sadhguru always says, you know, even he got into it for the wrong reasons and it still worked.
So, there you go. So how do we find classical yoga to try that and see what the difference is?
Yes.
Is there a lot of that around or do you have to really search for it?
Unfortunately, there isn't a lot of it around. I think the yoga industry has kind of grown and anything can be called as yoga now.
Yeah. What about the different types? We have, I don't know, 10 plus different types of yogas.
Yes, there's different things. Are we talking about what we see in terms of like the studio yogas?
Yeah.
Okay,
yeah,
so there's different types of yoga.
Let's talk about the studio first and then we'll talk about
Yes. Essentially, like I said, I teach classical Hatha yoga.
Mm-hmm.
And the classical just means coming back to the root. Now, the Hatha yoga, and this is why I said it's important to mention that.
Right.
Everything that most people see as yoga is actually Hatha yoga. So there is a slight confusion with this, that people think, oh, Hatha yoga is a style of yoga.
Right.
And I don't know, Iyengar yoga is another style of yoga.
Yeah.
And in like this, and that's not true. All of it is actually Hatha yoga.
Right.
Hatha yoga is the science of using the physical posture.
Yeah.
To what we say, go towards the state of yoga.
Right.
I've opened up another door there.
We have.
We'll come to that. So Hatha yoga is the science of posture. And the reason why there's all these other types of yoga is essentially it started off as different schools of yoga.
Right.
So Iyengar came from a guy called BKS Iyengar. He started his own school. So that's how it was in India. When it came to the West, it was spoken about as this is this style of yoga. This is because that was the only way people could categorize it. Here we have to categorize everything. Mm-hmm. So when people started categorizing it, then it became all of this, you know, different types of Hatha yogas, mm-hmm. and it just became yoga. But yoga is a whole science by itself. The whole idea of yoga, this is one strand of yoga, is using the physical posture. Like I said earlier, karma yoga is using action as a way of coming to the state of yoga. So yoga actually is talking about a state of being. It's a way in which a person can be. And the explanation for that, if I use the Yoga Sutra, which is kind of seen as the book of yoga, it literally says when you go past the modifications of the mind, you become yoga. So what that essentially means is when you are in a state which is beyond the mind and the body, that is the state of yoga. So everything we experience is either through the mind or the body, right?
True, yeah.
So when you go past the five senses of the body and the activity of the mind, you come to that state of yoga. Once you come to that state of yoga, then here is when you have a heightened sense of perception. And when you have that heightened sense of perception, absolute clarity comes in.
And how do you deal with everyone around you?
Well, you'll have all the clarity to deal with it.
Very good. So we've come full circle.
I think. Yes. I think you get the picture.
So clear.
My job is done.
Speaking of which, yes. I think we've reached our limit.
Right. Okay.
Is there anything that you would like to leave our viewers and listeners with to kind of end this chat?
Yeah. So in terms of what I would say to anybody, the most important thing is being the best version of yourself. If you can be the best version, the most joyful your version, the most pleasant version of yourself, you will see your environment changes naturally around you. Your opportunities come your way and you see things very differently. And this was my experience. And then all of a sudden, that's when you really want to adventure into life. You don't preserve yourself. Mm. You really want to open every door that comes your way. And that is the best way to live. And that is what I hope for everyone.
Shubhan, thank you so much for being my guest today.
It's been an absolute pleasure. Thank you.